Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. The Lord be with you. The Lord be with you as well. Our online viewers, wherever you are, happy Father's Day to you as well. Friends, today special, Father's Day special, and we have a guest speaker coming, Reverend David Ants and his wife Phyllis, and also with their daughter here. We are thankful that they are here, and then David will share the word of God with us today. So here's a background that David would like to share with us. David was raised in a Christian home and became a follower of Jesus when he was young. His parents served in evangelism in Germany, where he spent 6 years of his early life. He married Phyllis, whom he met in Bible school. And while there, they both felt that God was calling them to serve in West Kalimantan, Borneo Island in Indonesia. And for the past 40 years, they have had the privilege of working with churches in Borneo, Singapore, and Papua. I believe West Papua. God has entrusted them with 4 children. One of them is here with us, 9 grandchildren and 2 great-grandchildren. And this is what I like, the last sentence. They continue want to serve God as long as God gives them strength. So David, Phyllis, and your daughter, thank you for coming today with us. We are so glad to see you here. I have met David first time in Bali during mission conference in Indonesia back in 2011. Little did I know that he was Canadian, and I didn't plan to come to Canada. And we met here in Lethbridge, so what a beautiful coincidence. Friends, before we start, I mentioned David served in West Kalimantan in Indonesia. I have a quiz for you, and if you can answer this quiz, there is an exclusively Indonesian gift for you. Let me see. This is the world's map. Okay. Exception for David and family, you cannot answer this question, and also my family. So okay, show me where is Indonesia in this map. Which one? You point to the map. Which one? This one? This one? There you go. There you go. That's Indonesia. Okay, where is West Kalimantan? There you go. This is where David spent most of his missionary work, and also here, and Singapore somewhere here. And I was born here. Wow, what a big world we have. And God sent his people wherever God sense to bless the nations. I don't know who answered Indonesia on the first map. I forget. I think there is a Canadian gift and also Indonesian gift. Who answered this? Oh, I think you're pointing. There you go. Yeah, Indonesian gift. And I think from here, Marian, if I... There you go. All right. Okay, so the rest of announcement will be from Dylan.
Good morning. Just a few quick things to highlight. First up is just a note about the choir, and we thank them for the wonderful service that they've done over this last year, providing music in our services. And so they are going to be taking a summer break and resuming in the fall. In the meantime, there are opportunities if you or someone you know wants to volunteer to share the gift of music, please connect with Lavinia. And we can set up a time for you to participate in this service. Wonderful opportunity. Coming up next week, we have a number of things. It's going to be a wonderful, wonderful day next Sunday. And the summer choir is going to be doing a piece, Make Me an Instrument of Your Peace. And that is open to anyone who wants to come and join at 9:45 in the morning next Sunday. And it's an easy enough piece that we can go through it and do that during the service. If you want to just get your toes wet with choir without the big commitment. After the service next Sunday, we will be having a barbecue hosted by the hospitality and the spiritual life teams. So we'll be supplying the hamburgers and hot dogs and a cake, because it will be an opportunity to recognize all of the amazing volunteers that serve in this congregation to keep things running. So we'll provide the cake, but please, if you're planning on coming, consider bringing something, whatever you want to bring to contribute to the barbecue. So your favorite salad or accompaniment or side. And if you need more information at all, there's some contacts in the bulletin if you want to be more involved with that. And a thank you to Alani, who's going to be sharing some music with us this morning, as well as the wonderful women's choir that I heard rehearsing this morning, and it's going to be just a wonderful piece that they do today. The rest of the announcements in the bulletin I will leave to your perusal and prayerful consideration.
Thank you, Dylan. Friends, let's start our service. We're going to sing our first song, hymn number 300, Father, We Love You. I invite you to stand if you are able. Join me in responsive for the call to worship today. It is good to give God thanks, to sing praises to the Most High.
We will sing with joy to God, who has made us glad.
Let us declare God's steadfast love in the morning.
And God's faithfulness by night.
So come to worship God with thankful and joyful hearts.
Let us praise God's holy name together.
Let us pray. Loving Father, from you come vitality, love, and joy. Your peace is our companion, and your love is our strength, and your Son, Jesus Christ, is our hope, and your Spirit nurtures tiny seeds of purpose and potential, hidden deep in the soil of life, to surprise us with new life. While the earth begins to bloom around us, we bring you our prayers and praise, trusting that your Spirit will renew in us the gifts we need to serve you in faithfulness, in the example of our Christ, Lord Jesus. Amen. Friends, before we come to prayer of confession together, we're going to sing our next hymn, hymn number 358, There is a Redeemer. And again, if you are able, I invite you to stand. Friends, in unison, let's come with reverence for prayer of confession. Living and loving God, as we watch our gardens and our children grow, we confess we often resist the change growth can bring. We form opinions about many things and cling to them. We fear new insights and new directions. Forgive us when we think already know enough. Grant us faith like the mustard seed, able to grow with your blessing and to become a mighty sign of your life and kingdom among us. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn us? Only Christ. Yet Christ chose to die for us, rose for us, and reigns in power for us. And he prays for us. So friends, believe the good news of the gospel today. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and set free by God's generous grace. So rejoice in God's good gift for you. And may the peace of Christ be with you and also with you online viewers. And how about we pass the peace of Christ between one another today? Peace of Christ be with you on the balcony. So friends, today Ministry of Music will be our women's choir, and the song title is He, and this song comes from our own pianist Corey. So enjoy and be blessed. Singing today on Father's Day. Friends, time for the young at hearts. Everyone young at hearts, come forward. You are welcome to join. On the steps with me, I see some young at age and also at hearts. You're welcome to come forward. Ty and your brother, I forget, sorry. You can come if you want. Oh, there you go. Yeah, Leo. Oh, sorry, I thought you were not here. I didn't see you. So, today's Father's Day. What is this? What kind of day is this? Father's Day. Yesterday, no father. Tomorrow, what is it? Why today is Father's Day? What is that? What kind of day is that? Can anyone answer that? Yeah, why today is Father's Day? What do we do? What do we celebrate today? Oh, what is that? What do we celebrate? A gift. A gift. Oh, a gift of a father? That's what you mean? Oh, wonderful. Wow. Yes, a gift of a father. That's right. So, on Mother's Day last month, remember I asked you to summarize the most memorable event in your life about your mom in one word. Now, I want you to think about those memorable events in your life and then squeeze that event in one word. Ready? 1 minute, starting now. The most happy moments with your father that you remember, and in one word. Yeah. Time? Anyone? In one word? Generous? Leo, if you could summarize about your dad, what is that in one word? I remember you said happy about your mom. How about your dad? Sorry. Yes, there was Mother's Day, you said happy about your mom. About your dad? What is one word that you think represents your dad? Maybe? No? That's okay. Ben? About your dad, man. Happy? Oh, so, oh, happy. Okay. Thai? Love? Laugh? Okay. Wonderful. Anyone wants to share about strength? Okay. For me, about my dad is ACM, a can-do man. A can-do man. My dad can do anything. He likes to fix stuff in the house. He didn't talk much, but his hands so handy, he can, you know, broken things, he can turn into good things. Me, the other way around. Good things into broken things. So I remember when we first married, I always call my dad the first year, whenever I need anything in the house. Dad, I think I need your help. And then he comes, and then he is just a can-do man. He can do anything. That's about my dad. So today we are going to celebrate Father's Day, and we will hear a story about a father from a Jesus parable today from Reverend David Ames. But before we hear today's sermon, there is a Father's Day gift for you who come forward. There you go. I want you to, so if you open this one, you can write something to your dad, and then you can give it to him, or you can write something to yourself, maybe, if you're a father. So there you go. And so here you go. Maybe you can give one for Chris. Yeah. And I know that Kyle will soon be your father. There you go. All right, here you go. One kind. For you and your brother. There you go. How about we close today with the Lord's Prayer, okay? Together. Thank you for coming forward today. Blessings to you all. Good job. Good job.
Our reading today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verses 11 to 32, which can be found on page 78 of your hymn Bibles. It is the parable of the prodigal and his brother. Hear the word of the Lord. Then Jesus said, There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me." So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country, where he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare, but here I am, dying of hunger? I will get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.'" So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. Then the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his slaves, "Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And they began to celebrate. Now his elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has got him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and refused to go inside. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, "Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave for you, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours comes back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you kill the fatted calf for him." Then the father said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Dylan, for the scripture reading for today. Friends, let us pray before we hear from Reverend David Ernst for the sermon today. God of patience and persistence, speak through your scriptures and inspire our growth and gratitude so that we may be changed by what we hear. Open our minds and hearts to a fresh encounter with you, Jesus, the living word. Amen. Reverend David Ernst, time is yours.
Good morning. Have to get all wired up. I'm not really used to that. It's a real privilege for me and some of my family to be here with you and a special privilege on this Father's Day. After serving for most of our adult lives in Asia, and as Pastor Daniel said, in Indonesia and in Singapore, we settled here in Lethbridge, primarily because our daughter Maria is here, and she's a nurse, works in labor and delivery just very close to here. And so it's been a privilege to get to know a little bit about Lethbridge. I'm from Alberta originally. And like Daniel said, it was a real honor to be able to meet him. I thought it was about 15 years ago. He said it was 13. And so 13 years ago on the island of Bali at a conference that our mission had. And Daniel definitely, even though we were, I forget how many people, quite a few people, it was a privilege to get to know Brother Daniel at that time. And you weren't married then yet, so he was still single. And then to hear that he had come to our city, Lethbridge, to serve, a real surprise, and it's been a privilege to meet with him a few times since then and meet his family. That prayer that he prayed is a beautiful prayer. What a honor we have to be able to come to our Father and just commit everything to him. And I do pray that he will use his word this morning as we think about the theme, Thank You, Father. Some years ago in Papua, in Indonesia, I wanted to develop a seminar for the church that we were working with on the Christian father, or a father who disciples his family. And I began to think about fathers in the Bible who were good role models. And you know, I thought of some of those great men like Abraham and David, and then there were many others. We think of Moses and Samuel and Solomon. But as I thought about them, all of them had huge character flaws when it came to them being fathers. And so after I thought about it further, I came to the conclusion that only God the Father is our one true role model, which in a sense is a bit discouraging, but when I see myself, it's very encouraging because I'm just full of my own flaws. And then, you know, on further thought, as I was even preparing for the message today, I've concluded that being a godly father is one of the biggest challenges that we as men face. We prepare a lifetime for the job that we'll have, the roles in society, but do we prepare for being fathers? I really do believe that this is one of the biggest challenges that God has given to us as men. Well, our meditation is taken from that famous text that was read so nicely for us, Luke chapter 15, 11 through 32. And it has often been referred to as the parable of the prodigal son. But you know, Jesus does not just look at one son in this story. In fact, our passage begins, there was a man who had two sons. That's in verse 11. Tim Keller, a man who has had real influence in my life, and even though I've never met him and he's passed away recently, I'm indebted for some key thoughts today. He indicates that the parable might more aptly be called the parable of two lost sons. But then he himself realized that the heart of the parable is actually not even the sons. The heart of the parable is the father. So when he wrote a book on based on this parable, he entitled it The Prodigal God, Recovering the Heart of the Christian Faith. And he's also quick to clarify the use of the word prodigal in the book title. It does not refer to a God who has left us and then gone to do his own thing, but rather to someone who is recklessly spendthrift. It means to spend until you have nothing left, and he's referring to God's extravagant grace. so generous with his grace. And we see that in this beautiful story, which, again, I thank you, Pastor Daniel, just having to think about it and meditate on it has helped me to come to see my God as the Father in a bit of a new way. Today is Father's Day, so it's appropriate that we focus our attention on the amazing grace of our Heavenly Father. And I know there are applications for us as human fathers as well. So I'd invite you to consider the Father under three headings. First of all, the Father's two lost sons. And then secondly, the Father's love for his self-indulgent son. And then thirdly, the Father's love for his self-righteous son. So let's look first at the Father's two lost sons. And we are right away introduced to his younger son. He goes to his younger son first. He's the wild one. He wanted everything now. And he demanded his share right away. Interestingly, his father divided up his wealth, just as his younger son demanded. And then we read that when he got it all together, he left his father, turned from his father, and went to a far-off country where he squandered his wealth in what one translation called debauchery and excess. Gone. Everything spent. And then, to top it off, there was a famine in that land. So he ended up in a desperate situation. His self-indulgence resulted in him being totally destitute. He had nothing left. And so he was, in his desperation, he looked around for work, and the only work he could find was of the grossest kind, in the pig pen. For the Jew, the pig was unclean. It's not like us working in a hog barn. That's respectable work. This was working in a pig farm for a Jew, and that was not respectable work. This was the most degrading kind of work that a Jew could do. He had stooped so low that he was not even permitted to eat the pig feed. And so he says that he's starving. And you know, it took this to bring him to his senses. And we read that in verse 17. And sometimes we have to hit bottom before we begin to think straight. You know, for most of his life, he hadn't been thinking clearly. He hadn't been thinking realistically. And now finally, in that desperate situation that he was in, he began to think straight. And sometimes the Lord has to bring us to those places too before we begin to think clearly. There was nowhere else to turn. And only then do we turn to God. And you find even in our secular society, when there's a disaster that happens, what do people say? Well, we got to pray. And so, you know, we think about prayer for a little while, and then things get better again, and then we forget. But this man had come, this young man had come to the end of his rope. And as he was coming to his senses, he recalled the kindness of his father. Even the hired men have more than they can eat. This father not only cared for his sons, but he cared for those that he employed. And he made sure that they had more even than they could eat. And so this young son began to formulate his confession. He said, "I've sinned against heaven and you. I'm going to go to my father and tell him I've sinned against heaven and you, and no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants." He knew that he was a son, but he also knew that he only deserved to be a slave. And so he really adopted that mindset. And we find that he turned and began to go back to his father. We see here a classic example, definition of repentance. We see this young man realizing, coming to his senses and acknowledging his sin. Repentance is acknowledging our sin and then making that U-turn and beginning to return to his father. So let's leave the younger son there and let's go to the older son, the responsible one. And we find him being spoken about in beginning in verse 25. This was the son, the older son, who stayed with his father and appeared to be the good son. And certainly he thought of himself as that. He was the good son, the other son was the bad son, his younger brother. But you know, we begin to see his heart in response to his father's welcome to this younger brother when he came back. How did he respond? When he came back out of the field, he didn't know what was happening, and he saw everybody happy and this big celebration, and then he found out that his brother had come home, and now his father had put on this feast, and his immediate response was anger. He should have been happy like his dad, but it wasn't. It was angry. His attitude toward his brother, this worthless brother of mine. He despised his brother. In fact, he doesn't even call him his brother, but when talking to his father, he says, "This son of yours." He's also envious of his brother. "You gave him the fatted calf. You didn't even give me anything." But even more sad is his attitude toward his loving father. He basically said, "I stayed all these years. Year after year I worked for you." It's like he had endured that time with his father. And then he said, "I've been slaving for you. I've been working like a slave." Not just serving, but I've seen myself as a slave for you. There was no filial relationship with his father. He saw himself as a slave to his master. He was angry. It was so sad. And he refused to join in the celebration of his brother's return. So that's the older brother. Well, let's then go to our second point, which is the father's love for his self-indulgent son, the prodigal. We see first the father's craving, or the father's longing, a powerful desire for something. And it's summed up in that phrase, "while he was still a long way off." The father, it kind of conjures up in my mind the thinking that day after day the father would get up in the morning and he'd look in the direction that his son had taken off on, and he'd think, "Maybe today he's going to come. Maybe I'm going to see him. Maybe today will be the day." Every day he would look with longing. And then finally the day came when way off in the distance he saw his son. And we read that he ran to his son. He didn't wait for his son to come to him. You know, I think, unfortunately, some of us fathers can act a little immaturely when we see our disobedient son coming to us. We wait until he gets there, and then we give him a piece of our mind. But that wasn't like this father. He ran toward his father. He didn't walk. He ran. What does that tell us about our Heavenly Father? When I was thinking about it, I got emotional. Think about our Heavenly Father wanting to run to us. Have you ever thought that your Heavenly Father craves your love? He runs to you. So the Father's craving, and then we see the Father's compassion. We read that his heart was filled with compassion. We know that his son had been the pigsty. He wasn't given anything, so he was still wearing the clothes of the pig pen, the garb of the pigsty. He was smelly, he was dirty, he was disgusting. And yet we read that that father just ran, didn't take any notice of that, and he embraced this dirty creature and he kissed him. His compassion, he loved him. And then right away we see his celebration, the father's celebration. "Quick, don't waste any time, right now." He went from rags to riches. "Take off these filthy clothes, give him a bath, give him the very best clothes that we have, and put on the finest cologne from Paris or a place like that, a total makeover. And so we can imagine here was this young boy who had been looking like he'd come out of the pigsty, and now he's looking like royalty, all because his father was so happy that he was back. He gave him a signet ring, indicating, this is my son, indicating that this is my heir. He put sandals on his bare, bruised, and calloused feet. He went from rags to riches. He went from famine to feast. Imagine the finest Thanksgiving Day, or maybe later you're going to have a great Father's Day celebration. Imagine that the greatest meal you've ever had. Remember, this is the fatted calf, the calf that had been prepared, that was being prepared for the greatest feast. And it had all the trimmings. And so this boy went from the pig pen, pig feed, to a gastronomic delight. I like those two words. It was just an absolute feast. And when his father explained it to his brother, he said, he's gone, this son of mine has been dead, and now he's alive. He was lost, and he's found. And I'm sure that younger brother, his only response was, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Well, then let's move to the father's love for his self-righteous son. The father left the feast and went out to his son. The older son returned from the field but refused to go into the banquet. Remember, the celebration was in full swing. The father was so excited, and he might have thought, I'll deal with him later. He's ornery, okay. No, he wasn't like that. The father went out because of his love for his son. His love was the same for his older son as it was for the younger son. What did the father do? He pled with him to come in. But the older son refused and said, I've slaved for you and gotten nothing in return. How many of us feel sometimes like this elder son? I've tried to please you, God, but there's nothing in return. Doing the right thing has become a drudgery. Maybe we've forgotten that when we come to Jesus, we are brought into his family not based on what we've done, but based on what Jesus has done. We are totally accepted. We already have his favor. So serving him is a delight and not a drudgery. Tim Keller cites an apocryphal story. This isn't a biblical one, an apocryphal story retold by Elizabeth Elliot as a poignant illustration of the older son. Jesus tells his disciples on two occasions to carry a stone for him. This is the story. On the first occasion, Peter carries a small stone in order to save his energy. When Jesus turns the disciples' stones into bread at lunch, Peter is left with a meager meal, that little stone. On the second occasion, Peter, you know, impulsive Peter, he hoists a huge boulder upon his back, expecting a great supper. However, around supper time, Jesus instructs the disciples to throw their stones into the water. When Peter and the disciples look at him dumbfounded, Jesus sighs and replies, "Don't you remember what I asked you to do? Who were you carrying the stone for?" In other words, the elder brothers tend to follow a moral code of behavior for their own benefit. I'm a classic example of the elder son, rather than out of love for Jesus. And this, according to Keller, puts the elder son in a more spiritually desperate condition than the younger son. We're not told what the older son did, but we know that the father continues to plead with him. My son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours, but we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And I hope that brother decided in the end that all he wanted to say was, thank you, Father, we don't know. I don't know which son you identify with, but I know that God our Father is longing for a relationship with you, with each one of us. Maybe you are the wild, self-indulgent one, but you have come to your senses. Then come to Jesus. He's longing to run to you and bring you into his family and celebrate. Maybe you're like the older son who keeps slaving in an attempt to earn God's favor. Listen to his pleading. Come to Jesus for his total and free acceptance. We can't earn his favor. We receive it as a gift. And he longs to feast with you. I noticed that up there, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, we just have to open that door to him. I will come into him and dine with him. I'll feast with him and he with me. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch like me his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as wounds which marred the chosen one, the Lord Jesus, bring many sons and daughters to glory. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Thank you, Dave, once again for sharing the word and outpouring your heart to us today. Friends, we have something for you, fathers, grandpa or uncles who are here. So can I ask Ben and Sally to help? And also Ty and Tanya, if that's okay, to help with these pews and the right pews, Sally and Ben. And Elani will play a song, Here Comes the Sun. So fathers and grandpas or uncles, enjoy the gift from us. This is from the church.
There are two parts. We have two fathers upstairs.
Thank you, Elani, thank you, Tanya, Ty, and Sally and Ben for distributing the gifts. Friends, let us pray. On this day that celebrates fathers, we pray for families in war-torn communities where celebration is an impossible dream. We pray for fathers and families who face perhaps financial hardship and worry for the well-being of their children. And we pray for any who feel empty or lonely today, who fear the future or mourn the past. As summer holidays draw closer, we pray, O Lord, guide families to find meaningful opportunities to enjoy each other and the world on their doorsteps. O gracious Father, you hold all things in your hand, including us. Be with all those who carry on in spite of loss or grief, and with those who face pain or uncertainty about their future. Keep us open to your Spirit's leading in all that we do with and for each other. Help us embody the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, as we prepare to give our offerings today, let us remember the words of Jesus, who said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive." So let us reflect on the abundance of blessings we have received from the Lord and the privilege it is to participate in His work through our giving. And may our offerings be a joyful expression of gratitude and obedience, knowing that God bless a cheerful giver. Let us give with open hearts and trusting that our contributions will be used to further God's kingdom and bring hope to those in need. We're going to sing hymn number 138, "The Love of God Comes Close," as the offering plate being distributed.
Thank you.
God of small seeds and secret growth. Bless the gifts we bring to you today. Use them as seeds of new life in our community and in your world that you love. Grow results that we cannot even imagine within us, among us, because of us, and beyond us, for the sake of Christ our Lord Jesus. Amen. Doxology. May the Lord bless you.
Walk gently on the earth God has entrusted to us all and cherish God's amazing creation. Deep peace of the running wave to you. Deep peace of the flowing air to you. Deep peace of the quiet earth to you. Deep peace of the shining stars to you. Deep peace of the Son of Peace to you. Amen.